ट्यूशन फ्री,
आपकी बात अब कोर्ट में नहीं जाएगी। श्री राजीव चंद्रशेखर,
इसलिए मैं निवेदन करना
चाहूंगा। श्री राजीव चंद्रशेखर प्लीज।
सर, थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू डिप्टी चेयरमैन सर। आई राइज टू स्पीक इन सपोर्ट ऑफ द बजट एंड टू कंग्रेचुलेट द फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर फॉर द फर्स्ट बजट ऑफ दिस डेकेड। सर, इन 2019 द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया वोटेड ओवरवेलमिंगली टू कंटिन्यू द प्रोग्रेस टू अ प्रॉस्परस न्यू इंडिया एज दे हैड डन इन 2014. This is the Narendra Modi government's mandate, and it has tirelessly worked to it to ensure every Indian has a legitimate opportunity to improve their lives and be prosperous, regardless of gender, religion, faith, caste, or where they come from. Sir, every Indian will acknowledge the work ethic of our Prime Minister and his government. The results of this maximum governance, my various colleagues have already laid out yesterday and today. Without any doubt, sir, this government has set new standards on spending efficiency, integrity, and direct benefits to citizens. So, sir, Budget 2020 is a budget that continues this determined effort by this government, an effort that commenced in 2014 when it inherited a broken, corrupted economy. Budget 2020 is the first one of this new decade and is also the first one to take on the Prime Minister's next objective of expanding the economy after focusing the last 5 years on cleaning and rebuilding the economy. Sir, I have listened to the opposition so far, and as the Prime Minister himself said, sir, criticism and discussions on the government's economic policies are welcome. But what I heard has been either a bland political criticism or at best a patronizing, selective, fact-based critique. सर,
उस तरफ से कोई बोल रहा था तो यहां से कोई नहीं बोलता।
हाँ सर, आई वॉन्ट टू टेक ऑन मिस्टर रेस्पॉन्ड टू मिस्टर चिदंबरम्स वैक्सिंग एलोक्वेंटली अबाउट इकोनॉमिक मैनेजमेंट। ही ऑलमोस्ट इंप्लाइज दैट द कांग्रेस हैज सम स्पेशल स्किल्स इन दिस एरिया, एंड देयरफॉर सर, इट्स अ गुड अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर अस टू रिमाइंड हिम, द हाउस, एंड इंडीड ऑल द इंडियंस हु आर लिसनिंग टुडे टू दिस बजट डिबेट about his government's record on economic management. This is important, sir, but it must be placed on record. The consequences of this, the people and the government of this country are still struggling with today. Sir, it is no surprise that Mr. Chidambaram wants to very desperately for all of us to forget this record, because he asks in his own speech, why are we referring to his record? Why are we not forgetting and moving on? And the answer is very simple. The damage and corruption to the economy and to the financial sector, and important elements of the public sector that Mr. Jairam Ramesh is so fond of, has been so deep, it has taken determined hard work, time, and lakhs of crores of taxpayer money to rebuild over the multiple years, at the same time ensuring fiscal stability. So the economic management, I'm going to use this phrase repeatedly, sir, the economic management of the Congress government left an economy on the brink of collapse, average inflation of 10%, shattered government finances, fiscal deficit of 5.3%, full-blown current account crisis with a CAD of 4.7%, deadly combination of low growth and high inflation, shattered investor confidence, and capital flight due to scams, misgovernance, and compromised national security. That was economic management a decade ago. During your decade, the financial sector, sir, was in particular devastated, as my colleague said, worse than if a country's enemy had taken a hammer to it. Totally corrupted, whose scams keep exploding even 5 years on. A huge contingent liability burden on taxpayers to bail out the oil marketing companies and failing public sector banks. He's not here today, sir, but I wanted to present to him this clear fact that 1.76 lakh crores was a debt on the OMCs that he left behind in 2014, and the cost of the recapitalization banks that this government and the people of India have had to bear was 3.8 lakh crores. That is a total of almost 5.5 lakh crores. That is a direct consequence and only a tip of the iceberg of the economic management of the previous government. Sir, another economic management, 10 groups between 2008 and 2012, 98% of the banking system's net worth was lent to 10 groups. A problem that took many, many years to unravel and lakhs of crores of NPAs that the taxpayers had to pay. That is economic management. Sir, their economic management, every Indian suffered. The poor because of rampant inflation, the middle class because of high taxes, and ethical businesses because of crowding out of tax credit markets and corruption. So the economic management under Mr. Chidambaram's dream team government had this result, sir. Converting a growing and prosperous economy that was the legacy of Atal Bihari Vajpayee government into an economy in crisis. This is fact. Dream teams, they called themselves, but they left behind a nightmare in 2014. It is this nightmare that our government had to work tirelessly in the last 6 years to turn around. We converted a failing economy into the fifth largest economy in the world. Sir, staying on the theme of economic management, let us talk about what our government has achieved so far. In the last 6 years, apart from having to deal with what Mr. Chidambaram's government had left, it also delivered on growth and expansion. And my colleagues have already talked about the various structural legislation that we passed, the RERA, the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, the GST Act, the consolidation and governance reforms of public sector banks, etc., etc. But, sir, the most important issue that we delivered on was inflation. And I will quote what one of the most credible central bankers that we've had, Y.V. Reddy, said in 2008 about why the careful focus on inflation and not the flashy, reckless, headline-grabbing Congress-style growth. And he said, and I quote, "Fighting inflation is higher priority than growth because spiraling prices hurt the poor immediately, whilst economic expansion takes time to trickle down to the poor." And Shelja ji, he said this in 2008. If your finance minister then had listened to this, we would have not the problems. Yes, he should have, maybe. Sir, amongst the, I just want to outline the results of our economic management. I won't take too much time, but there's a list of them, but I'll just talk. Apart from inflation, on the issue of NPAs, the government has addressed this decisively. Growth that was 1.9 trillion in 2014 is today 3 trillion, achieved with fiscal discipline and macroeconomic stability. The twin deficits have declined significantly from the peaks of 4.7% and 5.7%. The CAD is at a historical low of 1.5%. Central government debt is now at 48% of GDP reduced. Foreign exchange reserves are at an all-time high of 460 billion. Average GDP was 6.7% under the UPSR, which inherited a good economy from the Vajpayee government, and under the Narendra Modi government, it's 7.4, despite inheriting a shattered economy from the UPA. Average per capita income was 1449 with a growth of 4.9%, and under our government, it's 2041, with a growth of 6.1%. Average CPI was 9% under the previous government, and we have delivered moderate 3% inflation throughout the term of the government. Sir, I can go on and on, but I want to say this. Our economic management, in sharp contrast to their economic management, because the topic of economic management was brought by Mr. Chidambaram, has delivered unprecedented macroeconomic strength and stability to the country and our economy. And that, sir, is a fact. Sir, Mr. Chidambaram, again, I use his phrase because his is the speech that Mr. Chidambaram said, sir, the government does not know whether the slowdown is cyclical or structural. So I can only say, I don't think he knows, maybe, and that's not surprising, but the government does. And it is both. It is both cyclical and it is structural. Every single problem of the economy and the financial sector in particular, as my friend Ashwini said, can be traced back to terrible decisions made during the UPA's dream team. Yes, there are cyclical issues. Anybody with some common sense, sir, and I don't have to be a former finance minister or an economist, to understand there are global headwinds on trade. There are disruptions in the global trade regime. So these are cyclical. For a person who has invested so much in one-sided free trade agreements, multilateral trade agreements that have created wastelands in our manufacturing MSMEs, to talk about those and to be ignorant of the fact that there is a cyclical issue arising out of global trade is to either be ignorant or to be less than truthful. Yes, there are structural issues facing our economy. Which economy that is growing from 1.9 trillion to 3.3 trillion will not face structural issues? 7 decades of unresolved issues like labor, taxation, logistics will appear as structural issues. So what is the issue? The structural issues are a growing pain of any economy that is growing at the rate that we are growing. And they will be addressed by this government as they have addressed every challenge before them. Sir, he is wrong on another count. He said 6 quarters of moderation of growth. So the real growth moderation is really 3 to 4 quarters. And I want to spend about 2 minutes to explain this so-called moderation of growth that they characterize as ICU and et cetera, et cetera. So the Indian economy is by and large credit driven. It depends a lot on loans. About 80% of this economy depends on credit. Throughout the period of 2015-2018, thanks to the gift of the government in 2014, the public sector banks reeling under the NPAs retreated from loans and credit. The NBFCs stepped up and provided for almost 40 to 50% of incremental credit to the corporate and the consumer sectors. In 2018 and 2019, sir, we are all aware, the country was beset by the ILFS and the DHFL scam. That has caused a consequent retreat and risk aversion of credit to NBFCs. Now, to those who are heavily invested in this narrative of talking down the economy and talking about this government's economic management, question should be asked, who allowed these big systemically risky NBFCs to grow without any concern for asset liability mismatches, for any concern of their financials? I don't think Mr. Chidambaram or anybody in the Congress, sir, would want this debate to continue, because this dream team will have to answer very, very uncomfortable questions about the UPA era finance ministry's regulation and negligence of these NBFC sector. Sir, it is in this budget that the finance minister has addressed this issue of NBFC refinancing and has talked about opening a liquidity window for NBFCs. So we are addressing even today the problem that they left behind when they left in 2014. Sir, one more point I just want to make, since Mr. Chidambaram is not here, I'll have to just keep mentioning his name. Mr. Chidambaram spoke about the NSSO survey, a survey for which he has expressed great admiration and has expressed support over administrative data. This is not a place, I know, sir, to get into a debate on surveys, but I want to gently remind him that in 2014, another member of his dream team, Sri Montek Singh Ahluwalia, said, and I quote, "The NSSO survey does not always reach the right conclusion," end quote. I will leave it at that, and he can, I didn't see him at that point rushing to the defense of the NSSO or anybody else, but obviously different strokes, different folks, different standards, different times. Yeah, but he did not.
Please.
Yeah, this
please.
Is also not suppressed.
Even this one is
please.
Not.
Let me finish.
Please.
Sir, my friend and colleague Ashwini also used a doctor, responded to this doctor metaphor that Mr. Chidambaram used to get some laughs from his benches yesterday to describe the economy. He called it doctor, ICU. But sir, as usual, he's fudging the reality. The real doctor scenario is this, since we are using doctor and ICU. If we go by his description of the Indian economy as a patient, the truth is this. Atal Bihari Vajpayee government in 2014 left a very healthy, left a very healthy, robust patient. Handed it over to a group of people who call themselves dream team doctors. Anyway, we'll come to whether they were doctors or quacks, but we'll come to that in a bit. Over the 10 years, that robust, healthy patient was reduced to being almost terminally ill. It is the Narendra Modi government that has taken that patient, revived him, and brought him back from the brink into a healthy person today. Yet, some pains remain, accepted. Some more recovery has to happen. those will be cured too. But this is the difference between their economic management and ours. The Prime Minister and the Finance Minister are determined not to allow this patient to relapse again through over-medication, wrong medication, and playing to the gallery, which is what you did in the last 10 years, in your 10 years. So I will leave this issue of economic management here, sir. I will take about 3 more minutes, sir. It is very clear, sir, we have very different ways to approach the economy. We do not do big bang. This is not about headlines. This is about systematic, determined working for the benefit of the people, working to improve the economy for all. Sir, I just want to touch a little bit on budget 2021, except and especially just one point. My colleagues have already discussed the budget. Sir, there is one aspect of the budget that I want to talk about, which is to be seen as a virtue. This budget is a careful budget. It is a prudent budget. It is a budget that is shorn of any flashiness. And there is a reason for it, sir. There are clearly global headwinds. There are global risks and risks in the global economy. And this budget is careful. And I say this in the context of Mr. Chidambaram constantly talking about the need for triggering demand. And I will jog his memory again about his government's reckless rush into a fiscal and monetary stimulus in 2008-2009, which his own favorite economist, Raghuram Rajan, then commented in 12-13 as a chief economic advisor in this manner. And I quote, that the stimulus in 2008-2009 caused inflationary tendencies and consequent high rates impacted investments and caused the slowdown of the economy. So, sir, there is a merit and value in prudent economics. And I congratulate the finance minister and the government for being prudent and recognizing the downside risks that exist today. So let me end by saying the following, sir. There was some mocking of this $5 trillion economy. My colleague Jairam Ramesh, who makes that his full... For Jairam's information, sir, it is trillion because it is represented in dollars.
Please conclude, Mr. Rajan. Ajay, please conclude.
A $5 trillion economy, sir, will propel the per capita GDP of every Indian to the $3,500 range from the current levels of $2,600 per capita. The economy will add, as my friend and colleague Ashwini said, an additional $1 trillion of manufacturing and large numbers of jobs to the economy.
Thank you.
Sir, one second, sir. That should be our goal. To replace Chinese jobs with Indian jobs as we set about the next 4 to 6 years as defining years for the goal of a $5 trillion economy. Sir, I end by saying we are off to a good solid start with budget 2020, and I hope we can all work together to make this $5 trillion economy a reality, sir. Thank you, sir. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Rajiv ji.